God has given me patience to deal with, I hope. If you have your faith and you have good community around you, and that's really our religious community around us is really what supported us. And having that community and that support and that brotherhood and sisterhood around you, it's really been the strength to get us through all this.
Welcome to Are You Real? Finding the Authentic You, the podcast that focuses on Christians that are active in everyday life. Join in as we speak to everyone from successful business owners to educators to athletes about their faith and how it helps them reach out and revolutionize those around them to do the same. And now get ready to roar with your host, the voice of manifestation, John Fuller.
Hey, Roar Nation, John Fuller here, and I am really excited, super excited, actually, to introduce, I have two guests today. I have Christopher and his dad, Steve. Are you guys fired up and ready to roar?
Oh, yes, we are.
Sure are.
How is that?
I like that. All right. Christopher Duffley is a 15-year-old inspirational speaker and performer from Manchester, New Hampshire. You might know him by his viral video, Open the Eyes of My Heart, that went viral in 2011. Although Christopher is completely blind and lives with autism, he hasn't let these things stop him in living out his life to the fullest. He recently launched his own podcast, Mission Possible, so that he can bring out not only his story to the world, but other people as well. He wants people to be encouraged to live their life, their mission in their lives. All right, guys, I barely talked about what you guys are doing, but I want to jump into, there's one thing you guys said, you have a viral video, Open the Eyes of My Heart, Lord. Tell my listeners, how many downloads or views have you guys gotten on both YouTube and Facebook?
Yeah, we got about,
probably close to 100 million on Facebook.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, and then there's different, we've never posted it. It's been posted by other people. So the video was picked up by an evangelist in Boston in 2011. He originally posted it and got the first million in a month. And then after that,
and all of a sudden it just snuck on, you know, other things.
Other different promotional
areas. It even got into a Hispanic site, I think, which was like 10 million
and
views.
And then it gets put into different languages. It was subtitles, and it's been all over the world. So we have no way of tracking it.
Wow, I mean, that's crazy.
You know, you'll find video like in Brazil that has 600,000 views on it. And we never posted it. We never put it in Portuguese, but there it is.
So let me ask you this. How did that all start? What was the story behind the first video that you guys did? Why did you do that?
Well, on September 30th, 2011, I was at the New Hampshire Night of Worship at the Capitol Center of the Arts in Concord. And I and my dad went up to do testimony and I sang Open the Eyes.
The church recorded it.
Yeah.
And then we didn't expect it, you know, we didn't expect it. All of a sudden, someone asked the church for that video and put it on YouTube. And Christopher had a YouTube video before, one other video before that, him singing with Matt Maher and Paul Coleman. Yeah, right. at an event. But that only had maybe 4,000 or 5,000 views. So, but this thing just went crazy viral.
Boom, boom, boom.
Right off the bat. And it still does. I mean, this year, you know, in one week, it got
22.5 million views.
In one week.
Just
on Facebook.
Wow.
You know?
1 week.
Another Facebook page has like 50 million views on it. So we don't know. When someone says it to us, we have no idea where it's going viral next. So the video lives on, you know, 5 years after it was recorded.
But yeah, it's going to be six in September.
But Christopher started singing at Christian music as a child with his grandma going to therapy and stuff like that. He would harmonize with his grandmother in the car and stuff and sing to Shelter the Lord's Kids was his favorite CD.
I know you guys put it on when I was a kid, right?
Yeah.
Yeah,
we did. Learned all the songs. He's very good at imitating and he had perfect pitch. So it was fun seeing him sing as a little kid. He sang his first time in public, you were 4.5 years old, right?
Yeah.
And we were on a mission trip rebuilding houses for Hurricane Katrina. And Christopher sang with the music ministry, and there wasn't a dry eye in the place at 4.5.
So I want to ask you this. Who wrote Open the Eyes of My Heart? Is that Paul Baluch?
Yes, Paul.
Paul Baluch.
Baluch, sorry. Okay. And you sang with him, right, Christopher?
I did. It was twice or once or twice.
Yeah, twice. He appeared in stage with him in Texas once, popped in when Christopher was singing and surprised Christopher.
Oh, my gosh.
And then
And then we surprised him in Boston at a well, obviously registered, but we sort of, you know, surprisingly popped in Boston.
Yeah, he was in Boston doing a music workshop, and Christopher sings "Open the Eyes of My Heart" in five languages, and Paul Baloche likes to sing it in multiple languages, and so Christopher and him sing it together in French, and then Christopher sings Portuguese and Spanish, and then a little Korean also. So
wow, Christopher, I want to ask you, how was that like the first time? So he popped in on you. That had to be a surprise. I mean, were you kind of starstruck? Did it mean anything to you? Like, what was your feeling when he showed up and that happened?
Pretty awesome, wasn't it?
I know it was a surprise. Like, I mean, that's definitely. And I know it's,
but not being able to see him was kind of hard. Yeah. It's hard to get surprised. tell you.
Yeah, you didn't know what he looked like, huh?
Right.
No.
And the other thing is, he played the guitar on the song. He came in and played it as Christopher. But Christopher sings it a lot slower than Paul Baloche plays it. So Christopher's made it more of into a worship song and slowed it down. So it has a different, it moves people's hearts because of the way he sings it and slows it down. And people really internalize it when Christopher sings it. So it's amazing what the way it touches people.
I want to ask you, Steve, specifically directed towards you, how has Christopher impacted and changed your life? Because there's obviously a lot of families out there who have kids that have been handicapped or different, if that's the word. And I apologize if I'm using the wrong word, but however you would use.
Special needs or whatever you want.
Okay, special needs. How has that impacted your life? And go into that a little bit on how that has affected your family. And obviously God has shown you some great revelation through that. What has been that process?
Well, you know, we always laugh when people that have known us when we first adopted Christopher, they like, did you ever expect that when you adopted Christopher, this little, you know, baby that was on drugs, you know, he was a drug baby when he was born. He had cocaine in the system.
I didn't take drugs, by the way.
No.
You mean you weren't hitting the pipe as a newborn?
No.
I'm glad to hear it.
But he was in the foster care system, and my wife went down to visit him when he was 11 months old, and she was kind of torn up because he was in and out of the hospital. He was very frail, and he had double pneumonia. And she called me at home and says, you know, I don't know if we can do this. You know, he's so frail and he's got so many issues. And I said, hon, we stand for life. He's family, you know, bring him home, you know. So it took us another few months to get him home. At 15 months, we brought him home. And then from there, you know, we saw his musical ability start to, you know, increase. But he still wasn't talking. And then when Christopher was 7, he went to music therapy, and his music therapist was able to drag sentences and words out of him through holding instruments back and doing fun communication songs and stuff like that. And then Christopher started singing the national anthem at different sporting events, and he started to get pretty famous for that. And then at different Christian festivals, started singing, being pulled up on stage by, you know, people like Matt Maher and Paul Coleman and stuff. And then all of a sudden, you know, he's 11 years old, and that "Open the Eyes of My Heart" video went completely viral, and we started getting inquiries from church.
I thought I was 10.
Church or 10 churches all over the country. So it was 2011 when you were 10. Yeah.
Yeah.
So that.
And by the way, Dad, you actually said you were in May of 2011.
Yeah.
I was born in May of 2011.
Yeah, yeah. That was
because you were nervous
on the video. No, I I was nervous when I did that video. That's got 100 million views. Has me messing up his name and him correcting me. So it's pretty funny.
Well, messing up my
your birthday,
my year of birth.
Your birth. I was supposed to say 2001, and the year was 2011.
2001. And you're like, thank you. You can do it better than I can.
Yeah, he can describe it better than I can.
He can do it better than I can.
That video has got me screwing up, you know, 100 million times plus.
That is priceless.
All over the world.
Christopher, I want to ask you, how has that impacted your life, knowing that a family, your dad and your mom, decided to take you in, and they've just absolutely loved on you, poured time and all those things? And how is that shown you, like, your identity, especially with, like, Jesus and those things? Can you explain that to me or describe that?
I'm turning away because I'm like, I don't know.
You can say,
way to answer this.
Well, you can say that your family is loved.
That,
you
know, we're, yeah.
You instantly had four brothers and sisters.
Yeah.
Was that exciting, Christopher? I mean, to know that all of a sudden you had brothers and sisters and you get a dad now and stuff. I mean, let me ask you this. How did it make you feel? Do you remember at a point where you felt, wow, this is awesome?
You know what? I mean, I have no idea feeling wise because literally I do not remember whether I felt happy or felt, you know, sad or, you know, or some other, you know, feeling in that case.
Okay. Well, the thing is, Christopher, you know, up to the age of 7 really wasn't communicating with us. He was just repeating whatever he heard.
Okay.
So he's really good at repeating songs and music perfectly. So if we wanted to sing something, he could practice it and sing it. But you couldn't really, there was no two-way communication until about 7 or 8 years old.
Not really.
And he continually is like a flower that continues to open and bud. So his consciousness of what's going on in the world and the impact he's having on people all over the world. We get people that will, you know, we get tons of Facebook messages and responses and comments, and people have died listening to Christopher's music. You know, that's the last song they wanted to hear before they went to heaven.
Wow.
And people have
just inspiring.
Yeah.
Have come to the faith just by hearing his testimony.
By hearing my songs, I'm like, what the heck? You know?
Yeah. Yeah. They'll hear.
I don't think so. Like, I did not believe it.
And they've come back to their faith, you know, people that are troubled.
They came back, but I don't know about converting.
We had one grandfather that used to make fun of his autistic, you know, grandson. And after hearing Christopher's, you know, music, really convicted him that he was, you know, doing the wrong thing and turned over a new leaf and said,
how am I a miracle that this is
it's amazing.
It's powerful.
And we get hundreds of the, you know, it's hard. You know, we print off some of the best ones, but it's hard to keep up with all the media, you know, especially when he starts going viral. He sang at the Red Sox a couple of years ago and his video went viral all over the world. He was trending #1 on Facebook and you know, you can't keep up with all the comments and, you know, how do you keep up with all that stuff? Yes. He did a Facebook Live and he got like a million views. And how many
on the Orlando on that Orlando shooting?
Shooting. He sang "Open the Eyes of My Heart" and took prayer requests, and he got like
20. And holy camoly, people sharing it. It gets to like
It got like 27,000 prayer requests. How do you answer 27,000 prayer requests?
Yeah. Well, Steve, I want to ask you this, and this could be for both of you. What has been the hardest part of this journey? Because I can't even imagine you're blind and autistic. And then Steve also taking care of Christopher. This is obviously, you guys have had to learn how to gel together and go through life, but there's had to be some moments that were really hard. Would you dive into like one of those moments? But I want to hear the bright side, the end of it, what you came through and what you learned from it.
The hardest part is trying to figure out what's best for Christopher. What therapy, what school, you know, what technique? Is it homeschooling? Is it, you know, traditional school? And in the beginning, Christopher needed so many services, you know, PT and technology and all those different things. And so this, you know, he spent probably half the time in the classroom and the other half of the time would be in all different types of therapies, just learning his Braille. And he's very good electronically. He's done very well there. And the hardest part is like, do we keep him in school where he gets the services? Do we homeschool him, which we did the last 2 years. And then this year we put him in a private school,
Catholic school.
And he's thriving there, which is great. But it took us 2 years to get him through seventh grade. So it was very hard because the public school didn't want to work with his travel schedule. You know, he has opportunities to travel all over the country and witness and to his story and to encourage school children to, you know, stand up for their faith. And it's hard, you know, when you got public school people telling you, oh, that's not important.
Come on.
That's really frustrating. So we went to online public school the last 2 years, but it took my poor wife, 2 years to do seventh grade. So, but he comprehended everything. So do you leave him in a public school where they just push him through, or do you, you know, take time and make sure he's getting everything? So that's been our biggest struggle.
And I go to Mass every day at Holy Family and I get good education there.
He's got a very good educational system now of small 14 kids to a classroom, classical education.
How did you know it was all 14 students?
Yeah. That's about the average. Yeah.
Yeah.
So in a 7 through 12. So he's in a nice private school right now.
I'm in eighth grade right now at Holy Family. So
So Christopher, has school been hard for you, or do you not know any different? It just is what it is. I guess you've never been able to see. Is that correct?
No, I was born totally blind.
Okay.
He has plastic shells, you know, and they're painted the color of my eyes, so he can tell people he has his father's eyes.
So you guys have matching eyes.
Yeah, we have matching eyes.
That's we awesome. Do.
But he and I are the only blue eyes in the family. Everyone else is brown. So.
Okay.
So, but Christopher doesn't see anything at all. So it's funny. People will say, you know, they'll see his beautiful painted shells and they'll say, oh, he can see. Look at those beautiful eyes. And we're like,
what the heck?
They're plastic.
I don't know about that.
You can't expect these plastic eyes to see. I mean, that'd be a real miracle, I'll tell
that
you.
That would be awesome. Maybe someday you'll be on stage and God will just turn those things into some organic eyes, huh?
Yeah, that'd be great.
Oh, yeah. Look at this.
It would be like in the Bible where the shells fell out of the person's eye. That would be his plastic eyes. And then he could be able to
see. I love it. Then you guys
you probably see my eyes right now.
You'll go from 100 million downloads to a billion or something.
Yeah, that would be a billion. Definitely a billion if the shells fell out and he could see. That would be a miracle.
We're going to believe for a billion downloads. Okay, so I want to ask you, Christopher, what do you think your biggest strength is? What do you think you're good at?
I know I am good at technology.
Okay.
I think.
I agree with you, Christopher, because you're using it for podcasting. So that's you're able to use your gift for technology, and now you're doing podcasting, right?
Yeah. That's right.
All his own engineering.
Yeah, which is impressive because you can't even see what you're doing. So that I mean that really is a gift and a skill. Yeah. So I'm impressed.
I use the ears to do it, so that's great.
He's very good at everything Apple. So he
can, okay,
he
can, I like it. So Christopher, what do you feel like your biggest weakness is? What's hard for you?
Weaknesses.
Staying focused.
Oh, yeah. That's so hard. That's hard. That is hard to do.
And repeating. He repeats a lot. So he keeps. He likes the sound of something. He'll repeat it 100 times.
Okay.
Yeah. That's part of the autism, though.
Yeah, it makes sense. I figured that was. But Christopher, what is the biggest thing right now that you feel like God's stirring inside of you? Like, what are you excited about?
Well, I am not only excited, but I'm honored to be at One Life LA on Saturday, January 21st. If you're in the Pacific time, you know what I'm talking about. 12 o'clock, the actual event starts. I think I'm going to be on after 1 o'clock somewhere. I have no idea. So, but
he's going to be able to share his testimony, and he's going to be able to sing with his sister two songs. You're going to sing Open the Eyes of My Heart and then one of your originals, right?
Yes.
Keep On, right?
Yeah, and we actually have it up on my website right now, ChristopherDuffley.com. Excuse me? What was that?
Nothing. That was Luke.
No,
we're getting sidetracked, Christopher. We're going to keep you on track, buddy.
No, it's all right. I'll just start it over again.
No. We're good. I don't even edit it. We're just going to keep going, buddy.
Oh, you mean you want to just... Well, it says,
okay.
Are you real, right?
So it yes, makes it a real this thing. Is real and raw.
Okay. Sounds good. So sorry about that sidetracking there, folks. So, but yeah.
You're singing in L.A. this coming week, and you're going to be singing with your sister.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. And I will be. I forget where I was, but this is live editing right here. So, so. It's on my website right now, ChristopherDuffley.com. It's a little about the top of the page. It'll say free download.
Okay.
You can go on there. You can just type in your email and your name, and it will send to you.
Keep On will be there.
Yeah. So nice. That's
I didn't even know that.
Though. That's the single right now. So
nice.
Steph, why don't you go on there and email yourself? And hey, maybe John will email you it. So.
And then the other thing is, it's going to be aired on EWTN all around the world. So
EWTN.com. Not sure exactly where you want to go, but you can always go and update the show notes.
Probably re-aired a few more times. So
hey, Christopher, when you're ready, I have a friend. If you guys go back to my podcast, I think it's episode number one. But
Really?
But listen, the guy is his name is Matt Dietz. And he has a phenomenal album. It's one of my favorite album. It's actually in iTunes. I'll send it to you, but I was going to tell you, he is a phenomenal songwriter. You guys, I need to connect you two, and maybe you guys could have some fun. He could write some songs, and you could sing them or something. He's got a song called Galaxy that's phenomenal.
Oh, yeah, right. Wow.
Awesome.
So I'll have to turn you guys on to it. So I want to ask you, Steve, what is a personal daily habit that you implement with your son, Christopher, even for yourself, just to have a solid walk with the Lord?
Well, every morning I try to get up before everyone, including Christopher. And I spend my first time reading the Bible, and then I have my morning prayers, and then I take about an hour. I try to get an hour. It doesn't always work, depending on the night before, how crazy it's been. But I'll spend an hour just in quiet time.
So probably about maybe, 45
And I try to get Christopher to join me in my quieter meditation time also. Then we'll jump into our 7-minute workout, right?
Yeah, we actually just started mid last week.
Christopher, you're working out, buddy?
7 minutes.
7-minute workout every morning.
Yep. Good for
I'm
you.
Like, no.
You're putting your muscle on.
Yeah, we're trying to keep got to get those.
Well, some of those movements I don't know, so.
We're working on it, though. We're working on it. So
okay,
we're doing that, and then you know, so that's pretty much how if I can start the day that way, then I'm centered, and I know my focus, and I know God's got my back.
I like the word that you use. I'm centered, and there's a lot of truth to that, because it's easy to wake up in the morning, your feet hit the floor, you're already running, and then you feel like you're off balance all day. So yeah, when you spend time with the Lord, you feel centered, and I like that. Steve, do you have a book or something that you've read recently that you would like to share with our listeners?
There's a few. I listen to all my books. I'm an Audible guy, and that's why I like podcasts so much.
Yeah.
So there's a few different books that I've listened to. Let me see. The one that I really liked that, gosh, I think I accidentally re-downloaded it again. Oh, yeah. It's called The Celebration of Discipline by Richard J. Foster.
Okay.
I never heard of it, but one of the guys in the men's groups recommended it, and it's very powerful. And
you searched on Audible, and you did.
And it's on Audible, so yeah.
Don't make it. We'll have to jump on Audible. I'll have to provide that for my listeners here. Pretty soon. That's funny you mentioned that. I was thinking about that this morning. I said, I need to get Audible signed up so I can start sending my listeners to there and provide that.
Yeah, it's a great service.
Okay.
I listen to probably at least 30 or 40 books a year.
And it's a free Amazon account, and all you have to do is add your credit card and pay, for the books. So, and for shipping, of course, you order on Amazon.
Sometimes I'll listen to one a week. So
That's awesome.
Just listened to a really good one called Never Split the Difference. It's just a talks FBI negotiator talking about how you approach, your conversations carefully. And it works with your family and everything else. So it was very good. It wasn't really written from a Christian perspective. But
I'll have to check that out. That's really interesting, actually. Christopher, I want to ask you, how do we find you? So for my listeners, if we want to check you out or just Google you or go to your website, how do we do that?
Well, as you said, you could Google me. You can also go to ChristopherDuffley.com. That's Christopher, DuffleyCom. You can like me on Facebook, follow me on Twitter there. And guess what? I'm also on LinkedIn. So
nice.
I hate to publicize it, but I'm also on LinkedIn. But yeah, although I'd hate to have strangers connect with you, but it's all right. So, but I do have a LinkedIn profile. I don't have it completely filled out, but I am definitely something.
You're there. So, we can find
but,
you.
Yeah,
he's really easy to find. He's
okay.
First thing that comes up on
Christopher Duff. Boom.
We're gonna get it. Okay, Steve. I want to ask you, what is a piece of parting advice that you would give our listeners that's just really resonating on your heart?
Dealing with a special needs family and Christopher and. God has given me patience to deal with, I hope, but dealing with every situation. But if you have your faith and you have good community around you, and that's really our religious community around us is really what supported us when Christopher, more than family and neighbors and everything else, they were the ones that really encouraged us to step up and to take Christopher. And having that community and that support and that brotherhood and sisterhood around you, it's really been the strength to get us through all this. Where other, marriage, the divorce rate of families with special needs children is very high. So
I can see that.
But having that support is a beautiful thing.
Yeah, absolutely. Praise God for that. Well, you guys hold on for a second. Listeners, if you jump on our website, areyoureal.org, you can find all of the resources, and I will have links to Christopher's page as well. We'll be posting it on Facebook and Twitter also. So come by. Check it out on areyoureal.org. Guys, thank you so much. Please rate, review, and also share the podcast. So as soon as you're done listening, which is about right now, please share it with a friend, family, somebody. Get it out there. There is people that need to hear other people's stories to inspire them, encourage them to go after their dreams and their ambitions. So again,
I'm going to get it out there.
Yes. Just remember, at the end of the day, be real, be authentic, and be you. God bless.
That's all for this episode of Are You Real? Finding the Authentic You. Be sure to go to rureal.org for your free questionnaire to identify your gifts and talents and how you can use them to help people become leaders and catapult them into their destiny to help others become the leaders of tomorrow. We appreciate you spending your time with us and look forward to helping you reach out and revolutionize next time on Are You Real? Finding the Authentic You.